Welcome back to this installment of the Foundations series. So far, we've covered three elements of the gospel. That is, God created the world and it was good. The Lord then created Adam and Eve, the first of all creation, to steward his creation, to be fruitful and multiply. But Adam and Eve were deceived by the serpent and they sinned against God, creating this broken world that we now live in, where we now are separated from God. But God so loved the world that he gave in abundance. He pursued his creation. And at just the right time, he gave his one and only son, Jesus Christ. We're going to begin this kind of multiple installment, going from who God is to who Jesus is. And today, I want to do a brief overview of the Old Testament, that is the Hebrew Bible, that is the Bible that they used before Jesus lived and people started writing about him in what we call the Good News, the Gospels, and the letters. But for today, I want you to begin by considering that the Lord God, so this comes to us from Genesis 2, verses 15 and 17. It says, "The Lord God placed the man in the Garden of Eden to tend and watch over it. But the Lord God warned him, "You may freely eat the fruit of every tree in the garden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die." Now we know that the first of humanity, that is Adam and Eve, they were deceived by the serpent, and it created this broken world. And last week we talked about the pain in nurturing the ground, and also the potential pain in women having children. But notice in this text that it says that if they eat of the tree, eat of its fruit, then you will surely die. What is amazing is that when Adam and Eve eat of the fruit, at least right away, God does not kill them. God does not do what he warned them he would do. Certainly, they go from everlasting life, a life with God, and that they will die eventually. But God, in his holiness, in being in the right, in warning Adam and Eve what would happen, has every reason to squash them and to basically make humanity stop with the very beginning of humanity, but he doesn't. Certainly there are repercussions, there are boundaries put into place, but humanity is able to live. And as you see humanity go about life, as you go through Genesis, we see again and again how humanity fails to live in right relationship with the Lord. And again we see the Lord becoming frustrated with his people, and yet in the same way, he continues to offer grace. He continues to offer forgiveness. I mean, it is amazing that in only 5 chapters, when we consider from Adam and Eve to the time of Noah, this is what we read when we get to the story of Noah. It says, "The Lord observed the extent of human wickedness on the earth. He saw that everything they thought or imagined was consistently and totally evil. So the Lord was sorry he had ever made them, and he put them on an earth." The text says it broke his heart. "And the Lord said, I will wipe this human race I have created from the face of the earth. Yes, and I will destroy every living thing, the people, the large animals, and the small animals, and the scurry along." I mean, God is tired of it. He's fed up with how humanity has come. And maybe you yourself, after listening to the last Foundations video about sin, you too are fed up with the Lord earth. Maybe you too, like God, want to do something about it. And maybe if we were to consider what is right and what would be just, it should be to wipe out humanity. You cannot deal kindly with one another. And yet the Lord finds Noah, and he sets Noah apart so that, yes, he delivers Noah and his family through the flood, but he also cleanses the world of its sin. It is a foreshadowing of the baptism that we have in Jesus Christ. The Lord totally could have purged the earth, but he doesn't. He once again pursues and shows his grace through Noah and his descendants. Now, the people throughout the Old Testament are constantly walking away from the Lord. As soon as Noah and his descendants get off the boat, Noah gets drunk, and the people find one of the sons finds him naked. I mean, this is an absolute shaming of who Noah is, but also shameful for the son to see his father naked. And it seems like this cyclical cycle of sin continues in their midst. Even so, by Genesis 12, we see Abram being called apart, where God makes a covenant, with his chosen one, and sets him apart. He says that, "I will bless you. You will be my people, and I will be your God. I will bless you in order that you might bless others." What an amazing part of the Bible is how vulnerable it is. In many holy texts, you see people doing the right things. But in the Bible, we see a sense of sin that people should be ashamed of, but yet it exists in the text. I mean, Abram, who becomes Abraham, not once but twice, gives up Sarah not as his wife but as his sister. I mean, the places that the people find themselves in should be a place where the Lord deals justly with them and delivers them to the death that he had warned them about back in the Garden of Eden. But keep in mind, the projection of where creation is going is not a dramatic reset, but is to create a covenant with God and his people in order that they can live in right relationship, in order that they can do work together, kingdom productive work with one another. But again, the people fail. When you go from Abraham all the way down to Joseph, and Joseph finds himself in the multitude of difficulties that he has, we see Joseph, beaten and left for dead by his brothers, but rather than killing him, they put him in a dump. And at the dump, a ragtag group comes and picks him up. And eventually, he finds himself helping out at the right hand. And over and over again, we see Joseph have poor interactions with the people around him. And especially when Joseph is blamed for rape and then thrown into prison, we wonder what good is going to come from any of these situations. But then, of course, Joseph starts discerning the Pharaoh of the time, the king's visions, and he is brought to the right hand and he is put in charge of everything. That then his brothers and his family show back up. And this is the place where in that culture, Joseph was expected to take revenge. And yet in his opportunity, Joseph tells his brothers this: "Don't be afraid of me. Am I God that I can punish you? You intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so I could save the lives of many people." This, of course, is the story of the Old Testament. The Hebrews coming into Egypt, and then so many of us may remember how Moses was raised up because the Egyptians had feared the Hebrews and enslaved them, and Moses delivers them out of slavery through, once again, through parted waters, and ultimately they will arrive in the Promised Land. Even when they arrive after 40 years in the wilderness, it's not easy. The people constantly are saying no to God's go. And yet, God finally brings them to the Promised Land. But again and again, the people fail. And people are put in place to call all of the Hebrews back to the Lord. First, we see the judges come into the fold to save the people. It's this weird cycle of how the people get themselves into trouble and the judges come to deliver them physically and through a militant attitude so that they might return to right relationship with the Lord. The kings are put into place to guard the people from continually leaving the Lord. But the kings can only do so well as their hearts are doing. The kings can only lead the people to the Lord as much as they themselves are in right relationship with the Lord. So again and again, we see the people fall away. When the kings fail, the prophets have to step up. And the prophets are constantly calling the people to repentance and to return to the Lord, because if you don't, the Lord's justice will reign. But even in the Lord's justice reigning, and the people are delivered into Babylon, the people will be eventually brought back. Now, even though the people return eventually to the Promised Land, there is a unique text in Ezekiel 10 where Ezekiel sees a vision of God leaving the temple. It says in Ezekiel 10:18, "Then the glory of the Lord moved out from the entrance of the temple and hovered above these mythical but scary creatures, the cherubim." And at that point, God has left the building. and he is never going to return to a physical dwelling. And at that point, we wonder, where are we at? What is the Lord going to do this time? Because, man, again and again, we as people fall short. Well, at the end of Malachi, we are giving a hint into what is coming. In Malachi 4, the last prophet of the Old Testament, it says, "The Lord of heaven armies says, the day of judgment is coming, burning like a furnace. On that day, the arrogant and the wicked will be burned up like straw. They will be consumed, roots, branches, and all. But you who fear my name, the Son, S-U-N, of righteousness, will rise with healing in his wings." Wait, what Son are we talking about? Are we talking about the S-U-N or the S-O-N? "And you will go free, leaping with joy like calves led out to pasture. On the day when I act, you will tread upon the wicked, and they will be dust under your feet, says the Lord of heaven armies. Remember to obey the law of Moses, my servant, all the decrees and regulations that I gave him on Mount Sinai for all of Israel. Look, I am sending you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord arrives. His preaching will turn the hearts of fathers to their children, and the heart of children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse." See, this is a prelude, a prophecy of who Jesus is going to be. It is in Jesus that the Lord will create a way for us to be in right relationship to him. And oh, on that day, what a glorious day it will be, something we're celebrating. As we go into this next week, we have a lot going on. This Sunday, we are going to be hosting Knox Presbyterian Church, and to have a pastor speak on their behalf that is candidating for their position. But also in the coming month, in June, we're going to begin this series called Life as Worship. Now, Life as Worship is going to go hand in hand with this foundation series. This foundation series is but the foundation, right? But the Life as Worship is, how do we use the foundation to inform everything we do as lives and followers of Jesus Christ, somebody that we're going to learn more over the next coming weeks. I pray that this series continues to be a blessing. I pray that your week is just meaningful and that you're continually sharing Christ with everyone you interact with.